Hi, guys.
Oh, my God, it's Ugly Bob!
What the hell are you doing here?
This is part 10 of my 26-part review focusing on Castlevania Dracula X. Now, this title is a bit of a conundrum because being released in 1996, it was the last game, Castlevania game featured on the Super Nintendo, and I don't remember how the marketing exactly worked, but if you take it from the name, you would be led to believe that this was a Super Nintendo conversion of the PC Engine game Dracula X Rondo of Blood, only previously released in Japan. Now, they were probably very much trying to convey this sense because the box art is lifted right from that PC Engine game I just mentioned. The problem with this is that it's nothing like Rondo of Blood. The levels have been changed. You can no longer play as Maria. There's less maidens to rescue. And the levels are completely redone, and the music is entirely different. The only thing that really remains the same is the basic story, in that Richter's gotta rescue these maidens, as mentioned, and then go defeat Dracula.
What I said about the levels earlier, there's one other thing besides them being redone. Unlike Rondo of Blood, which had alternate stages, there's only two alternate stages in this game, of which this video is using one of them. The graphics for a 1996 Nintendo game, more could really be expected, considering that this was also the year of Super Mario RPG, and even the previous year we had such superlative titles as Chrono Trigger. You'd think, given the relative power of the Super Nintendo to the PC Engine, its colors were greater, its processing speed, they could have enhanced this game in some way, like sharper graphics, anything like that. And it's unfortunate that the enemies and sprites that were used in this game were pretty much just lifted right out of Rondo of Blood. There were some new bosses, like the Cerberus and the Necromancer, so it's good for little unique elements. And they were well animated, ready designed, like Cerberus, who's the boss of the first level. But overall, the graphics, they're good for a traditional Castlevania game, like better than Bloodlines, but that was 2 years ago. Or even, they don't look as good as Castlevania 4, and given the relative comparisons that those games were on the same systems, and Super Castlevania 4 was released 5 years before this in 1991, and it had larger sprites too, you really would have expected more out of this. The music, as said, it's completely different. Now, this is not a bad thing. I think it simply stands on its own. Like, I like the version of the beginning, first featured in Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse, better in this version than the one in Rondo of Blood. Vampire Killer, it doesn't hold up as well, but many of the tunes are just as well written, if not better. Like, again, in this video, the music for this stage, I think, is some of the finest written in the game, and they did a good job considering what they were able to do with the lack of Red Book audio. It's unlike, say, here's a good comparison, unlike when the Game Boy Advance was released and they wanted some easy games, they just ported Super Nintendo games. In that case, they didn't rewrite the music, so it always sounded it sounded inferior to the Super Nintendo version, because the Game Boy Advance just wasn't as capable sound-wise compared to the Super Nintendo. It seemed like the developers of Dracula X on the Super Nintendo were assiduously aware of this and decided, oh, we can't use it, we don't have Red Book audio, we've got to write something different. So I'm glad that they showed that tender loving care in this game. It shows that maybe they weren't trying to pull a fast one on us after all or something like that. The challenge of this game, stage-wise, it's harder than your traditional Castlevania game because the controls seem stiffer than earlier traditional-based Castlevanias. Even compared to Rondo of Blood, it's almost like Richter's reaction time isn't as sharp. The stages are still designed in mind with him. It's like there's no unfair obstacles, which is, like, another thing they probably weren't considering. They were probably saying, oh, we're not having Maria in this game, so let's not keep some of the stages that would have been easier for her or something like that. Let's come up with something new. The most noteworthy thing to mention is how difficult Dracula is in this. He's by far the most difficult Dracula in any Castlevania game, simply because his attacks aren't different. He has his standard two forms, but you fight him over a bottomless pit with five or so columns that you can stand on. You have to move around quickly to be able to hit him, and again, Richter's somewhat shoddier control can put you at a disadvantage, especially in his second form, which comes down to get in the corner and whip the hell out of him, use all your hearts, hope you have enough to survive, because Richter cannot jump over him unless you're willing to take a lot of hits, and he can't really take a lot from that final form, which makes sense. It's too bad, again, I don't want to mention this much, but it's too bad someone doesn't make a hack of this so you could play Maria Renard in this, because I really think she could fly or jump circles around this Dracula and make her very easy. Make him very easy. It would have been funny. Fun factor overall is that this is still fun for a traditional Castlevania game. It's just that because of what it was trying to be, both underhandedly and what they wanted to do with it as a unique game, and you must consider the year it came out. It doesn't hold up to any of the other more superlative Castlevania games. I think it would probably rank fourth after Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse, Super Castlevania 4, and Castlevania Bloodlines. Bloodlines is less is more. The stages are reduced in this game, but they're still somewhat lengthy. Finally, it should be noted that time has been a little kinder to this game, because we've gotten over the initial reaction, like, you know, the promises they made with the box art, ripping it right from the Rondo of Blood, that it can be recognized now as a fine product, simply because you don't have to compare it to anything else, being far removed from the original release dates. So I think any fan of a traditional Castlevania game will have a good time out of this, but they probably won't like it as much as the earlier listed classics. Oh, and one more thing. I wanted to give a final message about my next review. This review I'm very excited about, because this is intended to be my magnum opus on the very best Castlevania game, Symphony of the Night. I was trying to get hear some comments from my subscribers and maybe other viewers that what you want me to do with this. I am intending to put it in four, maybe 6-7 minute reviews. I think that should be enough to cover all four different versions of the games and the differences, similarities, which one's the best, That's how much I love this game. I really want to cover it separately. And to try and make this project the best it can be, I anticipate it's probably going to take a little bit longer to post. I hope to have it done maybe by the end of the week, Friday or so. And I want your comments on this, so if you have anything to offer, please send me some emails through my YouTube channel or comment on any of my videos. Just let's help make the best possible video for the best Castlevania game there is. I'll see you next time when that review is done, and I'll have a good day.